Hey, Center Grace family. Happy Wednesday. It is good to be with you again today. And before we dive back into this parable of the trellis and we look at our discipleship topic for today, I want to just speak to the reality of our current context for just a second and hopefully give you something to invite your heart and also challenge your heart into. No matter what your hope is or what your expectation is for how the results of this election is going to turn out, I want to just remind you of a verse that I came across this morning in my own devotions. Psalm 146, verse 3 says this, "Put not your trust in princes, in the human being in whom there is no salvation." And then verse 5, "But blessed is the one whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is the Lord his God." The bottom line is that no matter who it is that we elect, no matter who it is that rules our country or any other country for that matter, at the end of the day, that person is not going to ultimately deliver us. The kind of deliverance that we need is much deeper than any government can actually solve. The kind of deliverance that we need comes from God alone. And this psalm, I'd encourage you, look at Psalm 146 and just encourage your heart today. Pray through it, even as we talked about last week. But you know, one of the things that this psalm ends describing is how God's reign never ends. And it also describes how his reign is perfect. We are waiting for the coming Messiah, and he is going to come. He wasn't on the ballot this time. But the bottom line is, and we don't vote for him, the bottom line is he's coming. And the God that we trust is in utter and complete control at all times. And we look to him. So we don't put our hope in princes or in any human being who ultimately can't deliver. Our hope, our trust is in the Lord our God. So today, we definitely need to talk about our topic for today, and it's the topic of Sabbath, because maybe you stayed up too late last night and you need some rest, and that's kind of what that word means. It also just means stop, knock it off. But the word Sabbath is most commonly associated with this idea of rest. And if you're like me, you probably do a really bad job of resting. I remember one time a few years ago, I saw a picture of a hammock. It was a cartoon, a picture of a hammock strung between two trees. And there was a man standing bolt upright in that hammock. You know, he's been given the opportunity to rest and he won't take it. He's just standing straight up. Or I think back to some research that I saw in 2015 where they had polled a number of Americans about the idea of vacation. Listen to some of these statistics. 25% of Americans in 2015 actually took vacation, and not necessarily all of it. 15% didn't take any of their allotted vacation, and over 50% of the Americans that took vacation said that they worked while they were away. We do not do a good job with the idea of Sabbath or the idea of rest. We just don't do it. We don't do it at all. And today, that's what I want to talk about. Because remember that when we describe this trellis, what we're talking about is disciplines for life that the life of Jesus in us can hang off of, the fruitfulness that Jesus intends for us to hang off of. And one of the things that we need is rest. Remember, too, though, that as we've been talking about, these disciplines are not ends in themselves. They're means to an end. They're means to deepening friendship with God and growing in fruitfulness for Christ. And today, I want to just talk about two thoughts again and another shape, and then we're going to get super practical. Here are the two thoughts. First, you have to recognize the fact that God has designed a rhythm to life. That's what this first thought is. God has designed a rhythm to life. But here's the other thing. This other thought is that we often get that rhythm backwards. We typically think of the rhythm that God has designed to life in the exact reverse order. We would all agree that there seems to be this rhythm of work and rest, but I say it that way intentionally because we think that that's the way this rhythm goes. We go from work to the place of rest. Think about the way that we design our week and the way that we talk about our weekend, right? It's as if we, I don't know if you do this, but we fall into Saturday. We like get to Friday afternoon, Friday evening, and we're just exhausted. And we just are longing to end our week with rest. What if instead of that kind of rhythm, God actually intended just the opposite. What if the rhythm was that we go from rest to the place of work? Now, again, before you kick me out of the church or make me feel like I've got that wrong, think back to Genesis 1 for just a second. When God created man and woman on the sixth day, and we're not going to have a conversation right now about whether or not you feel like the days of creation are 24-hour literal days, but just consider the fact that when God created man and woman, the first day that they woke up to was the Sabbath. Have you ever thought about that? Humans were created late on the sixth day, the text of Genesis seems to indicate. And it's as if when they woke up that first morning, the first full day that they were going to live, you probably would have expected that Adam and Eve were ready to get to work, right? But God said, no, you're just going to rest. You're going to delight in my finished work today. Go look at Genesis 1, 26 through 2, 3. But there are some other hints in the book of Genesis, even in chapter 1, that I think indicate that God's rhythm is that we move from rest to the place of work. And that is even just in the way that the rhythm of the days operate. Have you ever noticed that on the Jewish calendar or in the book of Genesis, the day starts with evening and it ends with morning? The text repeatedly says in Genesis 1, and there was evening and there was morning the first day. There was evening and there was morning the second day. It is as if God over and over and over again is reminding us that in one sense, our day starts when we go to bed. We actually come out of a place of rest to the place of work, rather than coming from the place of work exhausted like I typically feel and just falling into bed. Now again, that's just a change in perspective, but it's an important one. I think we need to actually think that and think about that and give some real credence to it. Because most of the time, we don't realize just how deeply ingrained our activity and what we do is wired into the way that we think about ourselves. It's as if we feel like we don't have a real identity or sense of self unless we're doing something. That's why that man was standing bolt upright in his hammock. Because if I'm resting, what good am I, right? But the bottom line is God gave us the rhythm of rest and work. Not work and rest, but rest and work to remind us that we are in fact dependent upon Him, that He is the really only essential being in the entire universe. That being said, God still wants us to join with Him in work, but that rhythm is rest to work. And we work from a place of rest. And you see how wrong we got this even in the New Testament. Think about the fact that when the Pharisees were thinking about the Sabbath, they ended up creating over 600 thou shalt nots to protect the Sabbath. In Mark chapter 2, there's this great passage in verses 23 through 28 where Jesus and his disciples are walking through the grain field and they're picking heads of grain and they're eating them on the Sabbath day. And the Pharisees complain about it because they say they're doing work. The Pharisees were so focused upon the things that they were not supposed to do that they forgot all of the freedoms that God had actually given them in and for this rhythm of rest. In one sense, it reminds me of the garden, right? They're focused on the one tree that they can't eat from, the one thing that they shouldn't do, work. They're so focused on that that they make 600 rules about it when all these other things, all of this other provision that God has given them is actually present there. And Jesus boils the text down and he says, you guys need to remember that the Sabbath was given for you, not you for the Sabbath. There is absolutely nothing that we can do to make the Sabbath more holy than it already is. God has made it holy. We keep it holy. And one of the ways that we keep it holy is by stopping, by resting, by reminding ourselves that God is sovereign and that we're not, by reminding ourselves that He is essential, and that He's going to get all of the things done that He actually needs to get done. And so there has to just be a point where we make the decision to Sabbath, to just stop, to rest. So here's the shape. The shape is that there's almost like this pendulum, and that we need to move from the place of rest to the place of work. But a lot of times what we do is we peg this thing out over here, and then we're forced to rest, right? Because we get sick or we have a nervous breakdown even, or something like that, right? And then we're forced to rest. But we don't have this rhythm. We don't respond to this rhythm the way that God wants us to. We need to start with rest and move to the place of work. And the only two things that God has told us that we need to do in order to keep the Sabbath is to worship Him and to stop. Just stop. Just rest. Just enjoy. Just delight in the things that God has made. That's what the Sabbath was ultimately designed for, right? Was for us to delight in God's good creation and all of the work that He had finished. It was designed for us to recreate, if you will, or recreate, to have fun. As a matter of fact, one Jewish scholar actually says that is really the only command that we should obey on the Sabbath is to celebrate. That we shouldn't be sad, but that we should delight in what it is that God has done and made for us in the Sabbath. So here are some practical things that I want you to think about as you think about what it would look like for you to rest. First of all, think about your personal style. You could say that some people rest the way that a solar panel is charged. You rest by being around other people, celebrating with them. Other people rest by like a battery power, right? You have to be by yourself. And that's the way that you actually get more energy is by pulling away. We would think about those people as either extroverts or introverts, respectively. So what do you need as you think about developing a rhythm of rest, a rhythm of celebrating, or a rhythm of stopping? What do you need in order to be recharged so that you can move back into the place of your work from a place of rest? But then secondly, what would your daily rhythm look like? And not just a weekly rhythm. You need a weekly rhythm. You should practice the Sabbath. You should practice one day in seven where you don't work and you just rest. But what would your daily rhythm look like? How could you move day to day from a place of rest to a place of work? Think about those things, church. We love you guys, and we'll look forward to seeing you on Sunday.